All right, everyone, we're ready to get started. Good evening, everyone. My name is Kelvin Reddy, and I have the pleasure of serving as the chairman of the College Republicans here at Florida State University. I know you're all pretty eager for tonight, but I just want to say a few quick words of thanks to the people that have made this event possible. I would like to first and foremost thank Young America's Foundation for helping us get Mrs. Campos-Duffy here on campus. I would like to especially thank Keith Work, who made this event possible, and I'd also like to thank the James Madison Institute. And finally, I'd like to thank everyone here tonight, especially my fellow College Republicans, for making this event one of our greatest tonight. It's my esteemed honor to introduce Mrs. Campos-Duffy tonight. Rachel Campos-Duffy may have gotten her start as one of the stars of the iconic show MTV's The Real World San Francisco, but today she is ranked one of Newsmax's 50 most influential Latino leaders and sought after for her honest, insightful, and often humorous real-world view of the news cycle and the American public policy. Rachel is a published author, communications consultant, and television personality. She is a Fox News and business contributor and a recurring guest host on hit shows Fox and Friends and Outnumbered, offering her unique view on public policy, parenting, and everything in between. Rachel has also appeared as a frequent guest on NBC's Today Show and ABC's The View. In 2008, she co-hosted the series of Speaking of Women's Health on the Lifetime Network with legendary Florence Henderson. Her advocacy work has included serving as the national spokesperson for the Libre Initiative, a non-for-profit group that advocates for the economic empowerment of Hispanics through limited government, entrepreneurship, and self-reliance. Rachel's debut children's book, Paloma Wants to Be Lady Freedom, is a story about a little girl's adventure inside the U.S. Capitol, inspired by real-life events where she learns about patriotism, courage, and her immigrant father's journey to citizenship. She has a bachelor's degree in economics from Arizona State University's honors program and a master's degree in international affairs from the University of California, San Diego. Rachel lives in Wisconsin with her husband, Congressman Sean Duffy, and her 8 awesome kids. And tonight, we are honored to have her join us here, and she is excited to talk to all of us about the dangerous realities of socialism. And so without further ado, please help me welcome to the stage Mrs. Rachel Campos-Duffy.
Wow, they gave me an apple box and I'm super tall right now. Is that too tall? You okay? Okay. So first of all, thank you, Kelvin. He said I had 8 kids. I actually have 9. I had a new baby September 30th, so thank you. I'm really excited to be here at Florida State University. I want to say, first of all, I want to thank Keith Works, who helped make this series possible. This is the Preserving American Liberty and Freedom lecture series, and we can't do it without wonderful patriots like Keith who are willing to help make this happen. So thank you, Keith. So he gave you the intro. I'm going to tell you a few things that, you know, maybe were in there and that you didn't catch, or maybe things that weren't mentioned. So my husband and I are our claim to fame, I would say, is that we are literally, and I'm not exaggerating, we are the first reality TV couple in the United States of America. My husband is also the first reality TV star to successfully enter into national politics. Donald Trump is just the second. So my husband kind of pioneered that course. But I think that the thing that jumps out at people the most is that we have 9 kids. And people really want to know what it's like to raise 9 kids in this very hyper-political, you know, family where, you know, their dad was a U.S. congressman, their mom is a political pundit and contributor on Fox News. And when people ask me what that's like, I have a very true story. My son now is the national chairman of YAF high schools. But when he was only 12 years old, when my husband first started, he was about 11, when my husband first started into politics, and around that age, we lived in a rental home. We were waiting to find a house that we could live in, and in that rental home, there was a basement that was a toy room, and we used to call it the toy room, because all the kids kept that, all their stuff down there. And one day, I went down to the toy room, and it was an absolute disaster. And so I gathered all my kids together, including Jack, who was around 11 at the time, and I said, listen, guys, you guys have to pick up this toy room. And then I left, And I came back about 15 minutes later, and the toy room looked exactly the same as when I had left. So I was pretty ticked off when I got back, and I said, what the heck happened here, everybody? And Jack said, well, Mom, me and Evita, who's his oldest sister, we picked up our part. Everything that you see here belongs to all the little kids. And I said what all your moms would say. I said, well, I don't really care who made the mess. No one's leaving this toy room until this is all picked up. And so Jack walked across the room to pick up a toy, and as he walked in front of me to pick up that toy, he mumbled something. And I said, what did you say? And he said, nothing. And I said, Jack, I really distinctly remember you mumbling something. What did you say? And he said, I didn't say anything. So then I looked at Jack and I said, Jack, what did you just say? And he said, fine. I called you a socialist. And that is what it's like to live in our house. Now, the first time I told that speech, I told my son was actually going to be in the room. So I said, hey, is it okay if I tell that story where you called me a socialist? And he said, yeah, you can do that, but it's going to cost you $10. So we're raising capitalists, which is a good thing, which is kind of what we're going to be talking about tonight. But before we get to that part of the speech, I want to tell you a little bit about my parents. A, because I'm very proud of them, but also because I think it explains so much about why I'm here tonight speaking to you and why I am so proud to be a conservative who stands with free market principles. And why I really want to be part of this incredible debate that we're in. You guys are absolutely this is a critical time. And you are really at the tip of the spear of what the future of this country will look like, because we're having an incredibly important debate right now in America. Now, my family, like so many of yours, chose America for a reason. It's not random. My grandparents didn't put on a blindfold and just sort of pick out a place on the map and decide where they wanted to come. They picked America, they came to America because there are ideas and there are values unique to America that make it possible for families like mine to rise out of poverty and into the ranks of the middle class and beyond. And like you, I have a passion for preserving the ideals and the ideas that have always been the secret sauce for America, the ingredients, if you will, of the American dream. And those ingredients are freedom, limited government, American capitalism, hard work, and personal responsibility. And that's it. In a nutshell, that is what I want to hand off to my kids, and that is what I'm going to fight every day to make happen. That's America in a nutshell. Now, my father's parents came to America from Mexico, and my dad was born in a very small copper mining town called Sonora, and he was the 11th of 15 children. My dad's family, because of the number of kids they had, was actually poorer than most in that town. And that was really saying something for Sonora. The Campos siblings had one green bike to share among all of them. And my father recounts a memory, a childhood memory, that happened to him in kindergarten that's actually quite painful to him. When he tells it, you still can kind of see that in him. And it happened that he was in line, and a fellow classmate very cruelly pulled his pants down, revealing the depths of his family's poverty, which is that they were so poor that their family could not afford to buy him underwear. And I suppose that the child who did that knew that when they did that to my father. But out of that poverty, and even the occasional humiliation, came a work ethic, came a resourcefulness that has been my father's greatest asset. Now, as a young boy, my father and his brothers were young entrepreneurs. By the way, I don't know if you know this, but Hispanics, it's kind of in our blood. Hispanics start businesses at 3 times the rate of any other demographic in America. So keep that in mind as you hear these stories. He and his brothers were young entrepreneurs. They would go into the desert mountains and they would cut cactus leaves. And then they'd bring the cactus leaves home, they'd peel them, they'd wash them, they'd dice them, and they'd sell them door to door. His father also taught them how to make homemade Mexican candies, which they would also sell door to door. And at one point, my father became an apprentice to a piñata maker in his town. And around 12 years old, my father figured, hey, I could do this on my own. And so he started his own little piñata business right out of his home there in Sonora. His mother, my grandmother, Beatriz, would make the glue out of water and flour on the stove. And then she would, when he was done with his piñatas, she would take it to the local market and sell them. At the age of 18, however, my father had to make a decision. Was he going to go and join the copper mines, or another place for opportunity, probably better opportunity, was the military? And my father at that time decided, I'm going to join the military. And so he joined the U.S. Air Force, which back at that time, you know, was sort of a new force and really exciting. And he met my mother on one of his early assignments as an Air Force GI in Spain. And they got married, and they started a family. And even as a soldier in the U.S. military, my father was never above taking extra work after hours. So after a long day of working on the base, he would work at a Chinese restaurant where he would wash dishes at night. My mother, who still was not fluent in English at that point, she swept floors at a beauty salon to make extra cash for the family. It turns out my parents would do just about anything they could to try and get their little family ahead. While working hard to raise their family, they figured something out about America, and that was that the fastest route to the middle class that they so wanted, if not for themselves, then definitely for their children, was education. And so when I was growing up, my dad, often after school, you know, he'd work all day at the base, and then after school, he'd say hi and have a quick dinner, but then he'd go to night school, and he was getting his education at night. My mother, meanwhile, taught herself English, because she picked up pretty quickly that English was the language of opportunity in America. When I was in kindergarten, she became a U.S. citizen, and she also got her GED by going to night school herself. Now, years later, when I was a sophomore in college at Arizona State University, I was around 19 years old. My mom was in her late 40s. I found out that my mom had registered as a freshman at Arizona State University. Now, I don't know how you guys would feel about your mom going to college with you. I was not thrilled about it. I was not happy. You can imagine what it was like to, you know, bump into your mom. She was Latina, so she didn't really follow the rules at the dorm. You're supposed to show your ID before you can be let into my dorm, but my mother would come unannounced often into my dorm. I did not like that. We actually took a Spanish poetry class together, and we graduated 1 year apart. I can tell you now that one of my great regrets in life is that I really had no appreciation at that moment, at that time in my life, for just how brave my mom was. Here, this was her second language. She was in her 40s and going back to school. It was truly a courageous thing. But what I do realize now is that my parents taught me and my siblings by example about education, about opportunity, about the American dream. And it is from their optimism and their dignity that I learned that I am not a victim. Today, that shoe shine boy, by the way, that was another job of my father's, is he would shine shoes outside of the mining bars in his hometown. That shoe shine boy that didn't have underwear back then, he is now very comfortably retired in beautiful, sunny Arizona. He has 4 grown children, all with postgraduate degrees. His kids and his 17 grandchildren live lives that have surpassed even his wildest imagination of what he thought his life and his children's life would become back in the day. My family, like so many of yours, is the embodiment of the American dream. It's the reason why my parents so love America, and it is why they raise me and my siblings to always be so grateful to God that we were born Americans. Now, I believe that that American dream that my father lived is in peril. And I believe that what happens over the next 10 months in American politics is critical. In fact, it's monumental in terms of what its impact will be for the future of our country. Because our country has never, ever been this close to losing the American dream. Because we have never, ever been this close to fundamentally transforming our economic system as we are right now. Now, I also believe that this existential threat to America, to America's way of life, comes in the form of a small Latina woman named Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. Now, I don't mean to be exaggerative, or you may scoff and say I'm giving too much importance to Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. I do not believe that I am. And I say that with all sincerity. First of all, I know a lot about feisty Latina women. I know something about this. And I can tell you that none of us here that want to preserve the American dream should underestimate the power of AOC. She is indeed powerful. She is courageous. And yes, she is economically illiterate. However, she is incredibly savvy. Like Trump, she intuitively understands that politics is fought in the culture first. Like Trump, she is authentic, and she tells you exactly what she thinks. And she is entirely like Trump, unfazed by her detractors. She takes on powerful people, and I will give her credit. She definitely knows how to win a Twitter war. The good news about AOC's takeover of the Democrat Party, and believe me, that this is a takeover, that we would not be in the impeachment right now had it not been for AOC. Nancy Pelosi was absolutely dragged into this by a freshman in Congress whose last job was as a bartender. And I'm not demeaning bartenders, but it is a spectacular rise in power that she has had. The good news is that we are finally having a very honest and open debate and conversation about the merits of capitalism versus socialism. I think before AOC came on the scene, and you know, Bernie did bring it to surface, but I truly think AOC is much more powerful than he is in many respects, and we can talk about that later. But we sort of danced around it. I mean, I think you recall, I believe that, you know, Barack Obama believes many of the things that AOC believed, but he was very cautious about how he presented things. You recall when he ran into Joe the Plumber during the 2000 and it was that 8 election, and he said, well, don't you want to spread the wealth? And then he quickly walked it back, and the media helped him walk it back. AOC is out and proud. She's not hiding what she's selling, and I think she's actually very effective. Thanks in part to AOC, socialism is trendier than ever. Democrats, especially those running for president, the globalists that run a lot of our world, big tech, Hollywood, the media, our education monopoly, are all promoting and celebrating socialism. Young conservatives like you truly are the only thing that stands between their plan. Last year, paid membership dues to the Democratic Socialist Party of America increased by 600%. In the recent midterm election, so a year ago from this past November, 42 candidates for office ran with the official endorsement of the Democratic Socialists of America. In a recent poll, a majority of millennials said that they preferred to live in a socialist, communist, or fascist state over a capitalist government. 57% of Democrats have a favorable view of socialism. There's been a 12% drop in the favorability for capitalism over the last year among those who are 18 to 24 years old. Students are graduating from high school and college historically and economically illiterate, much like Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, because there are textbook blackouts on the death and the destruction caused by communism and socialism. It's ironic, of course, that AOC, a Latina, is the leader of America's socialist movement, because she should know better, because no one knows better than Hispanics that these ideas do not and have not ever worked. If you know Cubans and if you know Venezuelans, then you know that they are worried about Americans, especially young Americans, who are falling for the same lies that they did, for the same promises of free and easy, for the same class warfare and class envy that Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, and AOC are peddling. I want you to watch this video, and then we'll come back on the other side and talk.
Socialism promises prosperity, but it delivers poverty. Socialism promises unity, but it delivers hatred and it delivers division. Socialism promises a better future, but it always returns to the darkest chapters of the past. Socialism is a sad and discredited ideology rooted in the total ignorance of history and human nature, which is why socialism must always give rise to tyranny. It's about one thing only: power for the ruling class.
America was founded on liberty and independence, and not government coercion, domination, and control. Tonight, we renew our resolve that America will never be a socialist country. We are born free and we will stay free.
The human heart desires freedom, and that includes economic freedom. Hispanics leave places like El Salvador, Mexico, places where connections to government and power are rewarded instead of ingenuity and hard work, places where dictators have promised utopia but have turned their countries into living hell. Video footage was recently unearthed of Professor Bernie Sanders praising Fidel Castro and his revolution in Cuba, which, by the way, if you pull up that video footage, what's really spectacular about it is he looks exactly the same. I don't know if it was that he started off looking really old and so then he doesn't look old, or if he just has some sort of fountain of youth. I know that the Obamas, Beyonce, the Kardashians, they all think that Cuba is a pretty hip new vacation destination. But for millions of Cubans, it is a place of unspeakable poverty and repression. I know I picked up a magazine once. It was a fashion magazine, and inside was this spread, and it was Retro Havana, and they had all these very skinny, emaciated models leaning up against these dilapidated, you know, 1950s cars, these dilapidated buildings, and it was really striking to see what were turning Cuba's pain into, right? Fetishizing it in many ways. I challenge you that the next time you see a fashion magazine glamorizing retro Havana, think about the repression and the poverty that would drive a mother to put herself and her newborn baby into a rickety raft in shark-infested waters in the hopes of reaching our shores, in the hopes of reaching America. Look at Venezuela. Not so long ago, Venezuela was the richest country in all of Latin America. It was considered the jewel, the place that all the other countries in Latin America aspired to be. In 18 years, socialism has made Venezuela now the poorest. And don't let Bernie Sanders or AOC or Michael Moore get away with saying that, no, we didn't mean Venezuela. We were talking about Sweden. That is a lie. They are all liars. Bernie Sanders actually lied just very recently at the Democratic presidential primary debate. He was asked by Jorge Ramos if he supported Nicolas Maduro and socialism in light of the violent repression and the unlivable conditions in Venezuela today. And Bernie Sanders says, no, I support democratic socialism. He said that he meant Sweden. He is a liar. Bernie Sanders is on record as a huge supporter of the socialist revolution in Venezuela. Only about 5 or 6 years ago, if you had gone onto Bernie Sanders' website, you would have seen a quote on there that he said that you were more likely to find the American dream in Venezuela than in the United States of America. And then one day, he quietly removed that from his website. And guess what? Nobody in the media has asked him about it, as far as I know. I've been looking. He's only pointing to Nordic countries now that socialism has destroyed Venezuela. Bernie Sanders isn't just about creating a massive welfare state like the places that he talks about in Northern Europe. He has openly and enthusiastically supported countries that have taken over the means of production as they have in Venezuela. And look, Sweden did experiment with socialism back in the 1960s when they took for granted the source of their prosperity. It didn't work. And so they reverted right back to, they reverted course. And now Swedes do not call themselves socialists by any stretch. In fact, some of the leaders of these countries have told Bernie, knock it off, stop calling us socialists. We're not. In fact, we're more capitalistic than you. The Heritage Foundation has an economic freedom index where they can rank, you know, on all these different criteria, which countries have more economic liberty. These countries score higher than the United States of America in terms of economic liberty. Now, it's true that they do have a large welfare state, but it is underpinned by ruthless capitalism. It is important that you, oh, well, let me just first note this. 16% of millennials, by the way, cannot properly define socialism. So it is possible that though young people are saying they want socialism or they like socialism or they prefer it to capitalism, they don't necessarily understand that socialism by definition implies the government taking over the means of production. But that is what Bernie Sanders endorsed when he supported the Cuban, the Venezuelan, and other revolutions. So make no mistake, Bernie Sanders believes in government seizing the means of production. And that's a problem for all of us, because Bernie Sanders right now is leading in Iowa, in the Iowa caucus primary. And by the way, he may become the nominee. I think he has a really good shot of becoming the nominee. Now, I'm sure, like I said, that AOC and Bernie Sanders throw around this term democratic socialism. Again, do not fall for this. There's no such thing as that. Ayn Rand actually said it best. She said, there is no difference between communism and socialism except in the means of achieving it, achieving that same end. Communism proposes to enslave men by force, socialism by vote. It is merely the difference between murder and suicide. Do you know who else was a big cheerleader for the Venezuelan socialist revolution? Hollywood actors, people and directors, people like Sean Penn, Danny Glover, Michael Moore. But like Bernie, Chavez's fanboys in Hollywood have never, ever apologized to the Venezuelan people. Today, once middle-class Venezuelans eat their pets, they dig through garbage cans to feed their families. The average Venezuelan lost 26 pounds last year. There was a very distressing story, an expose, I believe, in the Washington Post, I want to say. Might be wrong about that if it was the Times or the Post. Venezuelan mothers, many of them with professional degrees, are crossing over to the Colombian side, across the border to Colombia, to sell their bodies for groceries they cannot find or afford in Venezuela. I'm here today to tell you that socialism always leads to desperation. It leads to indignities. It leads to hunger. And for many, it has led to death. I was recently at a, not too long ago, at a graduation ceremony for immigrants who were taking an English language course through the Libre Initiative. And all the immigrants stood up and told their story of, you know, just how grateful they were for this opportunity to learn English, to advance their families and achieve their American dream. The most poignant stories came from the Venezuelans that were in the room, because this is so raw. It's so recent for them. It's happening in real time. One man stood up and he said, it was an English graduation ceremony, but he said it in Spanish, because I think there was so much emotion behind it. And he said, you know, he said, the most important thing that we can do in this room, those of us who are parents, is teach our children to beware when people offer you something for free. He said, I don't care if it's a washing machine or a bag of rice. Nothing is free, and nothing is worth your freedom. You in this room, you at this university, you have an obligation, you have a responsibility to be informed. College students graduate without knowing anything sometimes about history or economics, just like AOC. They're oblivious to the wealth and prosperity in this country, even the relative comforts they enjoyed that even our poorest citizens enjoy relative to other poor people around the world. It is unparalleled in human history. Our amazing way of life comes from a very specific economic system called capitalism. The day that we vote to fundamentally transform America into something it has never been before, a socialist country, will be the day that we begin our own slide into poverty and repression, just like the Cubans, just like the Venezuelans. So listen up. Those of you who agree with me on this issue of economic freedom, it is time that we really kind of throw away the charts and the graphs. They matter. But we have to start speaking about capitalism with passion and with our hearts so people will listen. It is not a bad word. Capitalism is not a bad word. It is, in fact, I believe, a beautiful word. We ought to own it. When capitalism is married with ethics and morality, it is very, very good indeed. In all of human history, nothing, no other system of government has ever lifted more people out of poverty. And that is a fact. And so we ought to brag about the amazing economic successes our country is enjoying right now, thanks to the free market policies that are being enacted by those in power right now. Because our media is not talking about it. But these are pretty darn good times for America. Capitalism, free market ideas lead to prosperity. They lead to upward mobility. They lead to the American dream. And we are the movement of personal responsibility that rejects dependency, that offers minorities and the poor what they really want: financial independence, not scraps off of the government table. And it's not just wealth, it's freedom. Our capitalist system has liberated and emancipated women. It's the exact opposite of what AOC and Ilhan Omar are telling and peddling all around this country. Because of wealth and the abundant opportunity generated by capitalism, women can support themselves. They can choose to live on their own. They're no longer financially dependent on their fathers or their husbands. We had a speech recently at a university where a lot of Antifa people showed up to come hear me speak about socialism. And they came and they were asking all kinds of questions after the presentation. But there was a young Chinese man who had a question. And I said, "Are you from China?" And he said, "Yes, I'm here as an exchange student." I said, "Can you please, I said to the group, how many of you know what the social credit system is in China?" Very few of the students knew about it. So I asked this Chinese young man to explain it, and he explained that, you know, what meetings you go to, what movies you see, what you pull up on the internet, the government's tracking all of it. And where your kids get to go to school depends on what your parent's score is, or whether you get sent to a re-education camp. What was fascinating is that afterwards I was talking to him and I told him, "Gosh, I really wish you would become an American." And he said, "I'm working on it, it's my dream." And then he said, "I have to tell you, I was nervous when I stood up." And I thought, of course he was nervous because he was standing up in front of his peers. He said, "No, I was nervous. I looked around the room to see if there were other Chinese people in the room." He was afraid in Wisconsin, at a university in Wisconsin, of his government. Socialism is an evil ideology. No one wants to immigrate to socialist countries. Now, AOC recently said that the world would end in 12 years because of climate change. I'm sure you guys all heard that. She now says Miami will be gone in about 7 years. But she also said that the people of Central America are coming here because of climate change. Yes, she said that the people of Central America are coming to America because of climate change. But I am here to tell you that no, they are not. They are not climate refugees. They are economic refugees. They are lining up to come to our country, begging to come here because they want capitalism. They want access to the free enterprise system and the opportunities that come from it. President Reagan was 100% right when he warned us that freedom is not passed on in the bloodstream. It must be taught and it must be passed on to the next generation, to people like you who will then fight for it themselves. And I'm here to tell you that just like World War II or the Cold War during Ronald Reagan's time, we are in one of those very critical moments, because the difference could not be more stark. Bernie Sanders cheered the Venezuelan revolution. We cheer the American revolution. They want to eliminate cows. We want to kill them and eat them and milk them. They told us that the new normal is no economic recovery. Conservative Republicans, with their free market ideas, just delivered a blue-collar recovery. Liberal Democrats want to hamstring our government. Conservatives want to rebuild the military. They want to ignore ISIS. We want to destroy ISIS. They support open borders. We support secure borders. They believe in free college, free health care, free food, free housing, and we believe in free speech, free enterprise, and freedom. This is the challenge of our generation, and we must engage in this battle. This is ground zero for where this happens. This is why you must take it as a responsibility to educate yourself, to be armed with responses to what you're hearing in your Marxist classes and through the media. Because you are the next generation, and we need freedom-loving, happy warriors like you to take the place of aging women like me, because I truly believe that the future of this amazing, blessed, awesome country truly depends on it. I want to thank you all for having me here. May God bless you. May God bless America. May God bless all of your American dreams. I'm going to stay and answer some questions if any of you have any.
Hi.
Okay, guys, if you want to ask questions, we'd like you to go to the back and start forming the line in the back.
Okay. Your name?
My name is Corey Adamick.
Okay.
Thank you so much for coming to Florida. Thank you so much for coming to Florida
State. Of course.
Thank you for your speech. I thought it was awesome.
Thank you.
We hear a lot about, free health care for all and all those sort of things from people who are really entrenched in just the socialist ideology. So how do we explain to people who are just so driven by that force the reality of what they are advocating for?
You know, it's a great question, because obviously we all like free. I like getting free stuff, too. And when you, a lot of times they'll use these Nordic countries as their example. And it is true that they do have a very generous welfare system. Some of those countries have huge oil exports, and so a lot of that is funded. But they are also highly taxed. So how many of you actually work? Yes. Well, I mean, work at all. It's interesting when you start to get a paycheck. Just imagine, for those countries, many of them, 60% of their income is gone in taxes. So I think that people don't understand. They think that it's really, interesting to hear them go, well, we're just going to tax the 1%. There is absolutely no way you can do the Green New Deal, health care for all the things that they're promising now, forgiveness for debt and free education. None of that will happen unless they start taking money from more and more and more. And it will absolutely be the middle class and the poor. I mean, you see it happen all the time. I mean, that's why I talk about Venezuela, not just because I actually did an internship with the State Department there, and so I have a little soft spot for Venezuelans, but because it's happening in real time, we see. And it doesn't happen right away, overnight. It took 18 years for that to happen in Venezuela. But it did happen in a dramatic fashion. So I think talking about the real implications, if the person doesn't have a paycheck, it might be harder to explain. But I think we need to talk about all this. And also this understanding of how much more control the government has. A lot of people say, young people say they like socialism. But if I told them that the government was going to run, the food truck or the microbrewery company they want, they would say, no, I don't want the government doing that. So I just think we just need to have this conversation. I think that a lot of the polling that's going on with socialism is a lot of people talking about something they really don't know what they're in for, because we're not teaching it in our schools. When you have a poll, we had another poll that came out, and I'll try not to be too long-winded, but it asks kids to rank, or young people to rank, favorability of different leaders. So it was like Hitler and Mao and Pol Pot and, all these horrible figures. And then it went down to Donald Trump, President Trump. And only Hitler scored lower than Donald Trump, which is interesting because, Mao killed millions of people. Stalin killed, hundreds of million people. It's insane, these numbers. But people don't know it. They're not being taught it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, what's your name?
My name's Todd. I'm a library science master's student here at FSU, though I have a history and legal background, so
awesome.
I knew a lot of what you were talking about. I went to this meeting because I understand the history of socialism. And it isn't just an economic system, it's political and social.
Absolutely.
A lot of these socialists, even the democratic socialists, attack religion, they attack the family, they attack gender norms, they attack the homogenous nature of cultures. And I believe a lot of what causes them to fail is they attack all of the foundations of a society that it's built on for millennia. A lot of the so-called socialist countries that they say that work, like Japan or pre-refugee Sweden, they're culturally homogenous, they're industrialized, they have high trust communities. Sweden no longer does because of the refugees, but that just really goes back to the point.
Right. It's straining their system, by the way.
Right. Absolutely. And I have the personal hypothesis that socialists shoot themselves in the foot by advocating for all this intersectionality and deconstruction of society, to where even if you had capitalism or socialism, nobody trusts each other and it just becomes pure chaos. I wanted to know your thoughts about that.
Well, one of the things that I am concerned about is that we're not teaching American history, we're not teaching civics. So I do think that, you know, you can sell people on a lot of things if they don't understand how amazing and beautiful our own American heritage is. I put a lot of credence in this, but it's obviously not everybody who's voting for Bernie Sanders, but I'm sure some of you have seen these undercover videos that have been coming up of Bernie Sanders volunteers. And it's fascinating. They are talking about, you know, and they're not just like volunteers. These are paid staff of Bernie Sanders who were recorded through undercover video. And they're saying things like, yeah, we gotta re-educate the people. One of them said, hey, yeah, gulags, I mean, yeah, they got a bad rap, but, you know, they're not that bad. I mean, this is kind of crazy stuff that really makes those of us who pay tuition for our kids in college, which I am doing right now, very troubled that anyone could come out of a university system as these people did saying things like that. So I do think you're right about so much of that, that there is an effort by socialists to sort of really create a chaos and a disinformation. It's much easier to fool the people that way. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Jared. I represent a group called Pro-Christmas Socialists for Trump. So ideologically, I'm still a socialist, but I'm a single-issue voter, so I only vote on the war on Christmas. And essentially, I'm curious as to what I can do in my daily life to not feel like the most persecuted man in America when I say Merry Christmas.
Wow, I've never had this question before. Tell me why you're a socialist.
It doesn't matter, I'm a single issue voter. The war on Christmas.
All right. Well, I say Merry Christmas. I'm fully behind Christmas. And there's definitely a lot of people in America who are fighting the war with you. I believe in freedom of religion. And so I think if you're a single issue voter, then I probably wouldn't vote socialist. I wouldn't vote for Bernie Sanders. I'd probably vote for whoever is protecting religious liberty. And right now that seems to be conservatives. Hi.
Hi, my name is Cortland Culver, and I kind of want to my question by like saying that I'm very much on your side. I've done a lot for like advocating the free market movement and things like that. But I'm curious if you, like, among our generation, obviously you've talked about a lot how socialism like is becoming more popular, the idea of socialism is becoming more popular. But do you think it's maybe on the part of it is because perhaps we as conservatives will point to somebody like Elizabeth Warren, who I wouldn't necessarily call a socialist, but she has a lot of like progressive policies, maybe saying like that's socialism, and then somebody in my generation would say, well, I don't hate all of her ideas. Maybe socialism isn't so bad after all. Is it maybe a little bit dangerous to call socialism, like to look at a progressive and automatically assume they're a socialist and maybe kind of weaken the term a bit?
I think that's a really interesting point that you make. I mean, there's definitely, like with all things, there's a scale, right? I mean, there's like hardcore socialists like Bernie and AOC. But in the case of Elizabeth Warren, I just kind of disagree with you. I think that she's somebody who saw some polling that said that, you know, a lot of people in areas that they need to win don't like the word socialism. So she's saying, I'm for capitalism, but if you look at really her policies and what she's promised to do to our financial markets, et cetera, she's definitely about government takeover. So I don't really trust that. And even in the case of Barack Obama, I definitely think now he's living a capitalistic life, no question about it. He's living his best life. But I would say that many of his ideas, for those of us who, you know, I was raised by a parent who experienced communism, and when she heard, when my mother heard many of these things that Barack Obama was promoting, her ears perked. I met people from the Eastern Bloc who said, this sounds like the kind of stuff the way they were selling it to us. So I think the difference is that AOC and Bernie are just very out and proud. But I think ultimately, the Joe Bidens of the world are a dying breed. And I think Elizabeth Warren probably agrees a lot more with Bernie and AOC than she ever does with Joe Biden and sort of that traditional Democrat. So I get your point. I think it's a fair one for sure. But I think any move towards socialism, I think we were definitely in danger of that in the last election and in this one in particular, I think it's a bad move. I don't understand it either. I mean, we're living in the midst of this incredible, I mean, in my lifetime, the economy hasn't been this good. I mean, the Republicans and the conservative free market ideas, in just 3 years of taking out regulations and lowering taxes and giving people more freedom to make their own way and create businesses, we're seeing what's happening. And by the way, it's a sensible, I like some of the things that Donald Trump has done to, or President Trump has done to combat the globalization and make sure that our manufacturing is still, you know, he's using tariffs to get more freedom, if you will. He's using tariffs to get radical reduction in tariffs. So I don't know how you can defend socialism right now. It's really perplexing to me that it remains popular. And the only thing I can think of is that they just don't know what they're signing up for. They don't know what they're going to get or vote for in voting for Bernie Sanders, because this is working out pretty well financially and economically. And by the way, the wages are rising for the lowest income brackets. It's rising the fastest. This is a blue-collar recovery. They call them dirty fingernail jobs. Those kind of jobs are on the rise, and people are making, you know, family wages. The hourly rate is rising without the government having to mandate it. I mean, this is an extraordinarily prosperous time we're living in, and it's very clear that it's capitalism. So it's fascinating. Thank you. Hi.
Hi.
What's your name?
My name's Nate. Thank you so much for coming to Florida State. I have lots of questions I want to ask you, but I'll just go with one. Do you think this current trend of socialism with AOC, Bernie Sanders, Omar, do you think it's going to die out, or do you think it's going to continue going on? So, like, I'm a descendant of people that fled Nazi Germany, so it's really important that I see this die out, and thank you so much for your fight against socialism. So,
thank you.
What do you think about it?
I think that this fight will continue. I think if you go back and you listen to Ronald Reagan's speeches, he was kind of saying the same thing. I think every generation has to fight it. What I think is different is that I think a lot of it has to do with what happens at universities. So as conservatives, we have entirely ceded the higher education system to progressives and to really far, far leftists. And I think that what's happening is we're just getting a generation of people graduating, believing socialism is good, never hearing about all the negative stuff about it. And so I think the problem is the university system. So until we start to take that back, that's why YAF comes to the university and puts on series like this. But this is not enough. I mean, you know, my daughter's at a university where, you know, in the last year and a half, she's maybe encountered two professors who are conservative or at least neutral on these kinds of issues. That's problematic. So I think the battle will continue. I also think, interestingly, that up until now, they've also had a monopoly on culture. And one of the things that excited me about, you know, I come from the reality television world, so I understand popular culture and its impact and its power. And I would say most conservatives don't, because they just don't. and also we're kind of barred oftentimes from that culture. There's a gate. And when Donald Trump was running for president, you can go back and look at my tweets, I said, this guy's gonna change the game. This guy is a creature of popular culture. I mean, you see, whether it's, you know, the Oscars, Kobe Bryant, you know, tragic accident, you name the pop culture thing that's happening, and he's in it, and he's commenting on it. I think he even commented on Mexit, you know, the Meghan Markle thing. I mean, he's commenting, and he is involved in everything that has to do with culture, and he's been doing it for long before he was running for president. And I think that that's interesting, because I don't think anyone who's been associated with conservatives has ever had that kind of a imprint on popular culture. Love them or hate them. I mean, sometimes, you know, some of the rap songs that have been written about him are violent, but he's still in the rap song, you know? So he is a creature of popular culture, and I think that that is an interesting space for conservatives to be in. That is the space that AOC plays, and she's effective, and social media. You know, even with social media, he's so, you know, he writes his own tweets. You can tell. And, you know, Barack Obama was smart and had a lot of money, but he had these really, you know, savvy young kids doing his tweets, and they weren't as effective, they weren't as interesting, they weren't as spontaneous, they didn't sometimes step in it, which makes us all want to see what his feed is that day. So this is somebody who is in touch with modern forms of communication and popular culture on a scale Republicans have never seen. The closest is Ronald Reagan, and I think that Donald Trump has even surpassed that. Thank you. You got it.
Okay, the next question is the last question.
Let's get another, after you, we'll get another girl in here too, so go ahead.
Hey, my name's Stefano. AOC talks a lot about this Green New Deal, making like all our cars electric and, you know, not eating like a lot of like meat or beef or whatever. I just wonder like how like we can do our part to like make sure, you know, like our cars still have like actual engines, you know, use fossil fuels, and like we support the big fossil fuel industry, and like that like our burgers stay meat. Like, that's my concern. You know, that we don't have this impossible crap, right? You know, like Burger King or Dunkin' Donuts. It's real meat. That's my concern.
Well, so first of all, the Green New Deal, highly unrealistic in terms of its cost, the impact. You know, it will hurt poor people the most. Where I live, fossil fuels make heating your home cheaper. Rich people don't worry about paying that bill. It's poor people who worry about that. In addition, you know, you saw just recently we had this incident in Iraq with the embassy and Iran and all this kind of stuff. You notice the oil prices didn't change. I think that, and we're actually having real conversations for the first time about, you know, and both left and right, factions of the left and right agreeing that we should get out of the Middle East. And we can actually, you know, entertain that idea. Why? Because since Donald Trump came and changed the policies from the previous administration, we're energy independent. We're the number one oil producers in the world now, and energy producers in the world. That gives us a freedom in terms of our foreign policy that actually can save lives. It means that we don't have to send our blood and our treasure over to parts of the world that actually hate us in many places that we got oil, and we can make decisions that are right for our country and that aren't dependent on what the price of oil is going to be the next day. So I think that it's very unrealistic. I believe that many of the progressives are missing the boat on environmentalism. I want clean air. I want clean water. I get disgusted by what I'm seeing happen to a beautiful city, San Francisco, that I used to live in. It's truly one of the most beautiful cities in the country. And you see what's happening there. The feces and the water that's getting contaminated. There's all kinds of just litter and trash. What happened to that part of environmentalism? There's some simple things we can do I think somebody took a camera into AOC's congressional district and found, you know, just it's dirty, lots of trash all over the streets. And here she is trying to save the world. It's like, save your district, pick up the trash, do something. You know, I thought all politics was local and communities matter. So I think that there's a way to care for our environment and not pollute. And by the way, if you care about the global conditions for pollution, then you ought to be protesting outside of the Chinese embassy, outside of the Indian embassy. Those are the true polluters. We have an ethos, but also we have the luxury of having enough prosperity that we can deal with our own environmental problems in a way that other poor countries can't. But there are countries like China that just refuse to and are basically cheating in that regard. So thank you for your question. Long answer. I'll try and make this a short answer. Come on up. Your name?
My name is Isabel Mayday. I'd like to thank you for actually taking the time to answer my question.
Sure.
And for coming out. Anyways, I just wanted to ask, so throughout my education school years, like personally experiencing it, I've seen professors and teachers and even like school-wide like counselors and principals like promote biased ideologies like within, I guess like common like core concepts like within school lessons, like promoting all these biased ideologies mainly towards the left. How exactly would you like, I guess, combat that? Like, how would you like show our children before like they're manipulated and becoming liberals? Because I mean, liberalism is not bad, don't get me wrong. And everyone has the right to freedom of speech and freedom of religion and freedom of belief. But when it comes to the point that it's taking away another person's freedom, that they don't have the chance to actually have the chance of their own freedom of choice, I feel as though it's wrong. And so the fact that they're kind of manipulating at such a young age within our school system, I just want your opinion, like how exactly do you combat that?
It's a fantastic question and one that I've been grappling with. So I've been speaking at universities, but now in addition to that, I have been trying to get the message out through my social media, through my television appearances and so forth, that really we have to start much younger. Because the indoctrination is starting much younger. Some of the indoctrination is happening in books that are geared toward 3, 4, 5-year-olds. It's just very subtle. I've written articles on those kind of books. But also, you know, as parents, as a parent, it's my responsibility to teach my kids about capitalism. I try and use whatever opportunity I have, whether it's at the dinner table or when they're in the back of my car and we're driving somewhere. I talk to them about what's happening in Venezuela. I remind them, I live in a Rust Belt, Midwestern manufacturing town. I mean, it's hard to see when you're in D.C. or New York or L.A. I mean, the economy hasn't changed that much between what it was under the previous administration and this administration. If you live in middle America, in these forgotten towns that depend on a factory or so forth, it's really incredible what's happened. Our towns are having a revival, a renaissance, a rebirth, economically speaking. It's been amazing. But we need to arm our kids with that information at a very young age, not just have debates with them over Thanksgiving when they come back with all these ideas in their heads after a semester or two at university. We need to actually arm them with information. And what's beautiful about this time isn't just that there are podcasts and live lecture series like this that aren't just going to this room. This is now going out through YAF's social media to thousands of other young people. But there are so many resources out there, and the best way to combat this, it's impossible in a classroom where a teacher has so much power and information over you. You have to be informed. I know it's really easy to get on our phones and there's a lot of quick information, but we really need to be much more rooted in the foundations of our country, on our civic system, on our history, and be informed on what's happening in the world. A lot of people don't know, like I said, didn't know about the social credit system in China. You know, these were Antifa people in the line right behind him who were advocating for you know, that system of government essentially and didn't even know about it. So we have to be informed on current events, on our history. And then people like me who are parents need to do a better job of teaching our kids so they can be armed as they go through school. One of the troubling things that I found as a parent was that and how I discovered it was happening so early, when my kids were in very early high school, freshman year, they were writing essays, you know, they ask you to edit their paper. And many times my kids would say to me, "Mom, would you edit my paper? But please don't get mad, I had to write what the teacher said." And so they automatically, they knew what their teacher wanted them to say from an ideological perspective. They didn't want to get a bad grade. They want to apply to a good college, and so they were forced to write this stuff. The difference is my kids actually, because of the conversations and the kind of family they grew up in, actually knew that, you know, what they believed or had some questions about, at least questioned what the teacher was putting forth as a fact. But I think a lot of people don't know and just accept what the teacher says, or what's most scary is I'm just seeing a lot of young people in college, high school, and even junior high self-censoring. This is the kind of stuff that happened in East Germany. It's the kind of stuff that happened in the Soviet Union where people just self-censor. And what happens when you self-censor is ultimately you stop thinking for yourself. And that's a scary world that we're starting to live in. And that's why I take time to come and talk to you guys. And I hope that it, you know, your questions, what I presented today, gives you at least some food for thought. And my wish and my prayer and my hope for all of you is that you'll take this information, not on its face value, but just go back and do your own research. Do some reading. Do some listening to podcasts. Get some good books and get some foundation so that you can fight this. Because I'm telling you, it doesn't take very long. We have never, ever been this close to becoming a socialist country. If for example, Bernie Sanders, right now, right before I came on, Joe Biden, they said that they may now have witnesses allowed in the impeachment trial. I mean, truly, conservatives have no idea how that will turn out. That could turn out okay for them, could turn out very bad. We don't know. But what could happen as they bring witnesses is that Joe Biden is probably going to come down, because all that stuff about Hunter Biden and him is probably not going to look very good, which will be give an advantage to the next runner-up, who is who? Bernie Sanders. We are very, very close to that. We just don't know what's going to happen over the next 10 months. And you guys are at ground zero. So thank you for coming. Thank you again to those who have sponsored this, Keith Works, and for this lecture series, and for FSU for sponsoring us. Thank you so much.
So you want your safe space. The last thing you want is somebody invading your campus. You should always feel like you're right.
Freedom is not an abstraction. It affects our happiness and our ability to flourish.
It is very seldom that liberty of any kind is lost all at once. It's always lost bit by bit.
If we have protection of freedom of speech, if we said only things that other people liked, we'd have no reason to protect it.
Notice that when Jefferson looks for a source of our rights, he can only find one, and that's the Creator.
We are a country that respects religious liberty. That key value has been enshrined in our founding documents.
We are created equal in the eyes of God, the core principle of democracy.
To believe that Islam is a religion of peace is to believe that Muslims throughout history have misunderstood their own religion.
Life is the most fundamental right. None of the other rights that are listed in the Bill of Rights actually exist without first the right to life.
Free markets fundamentally run on service, not to make everyone's outcomes equal. We are diverse people with diverse skills and diverse talents.
Femininity is one of the graces of our world, one of the things that makes life worth living. Feminism has sucked all the joy out of that.
They've attacked manliness itself,
They've attacked the virtues. Virtue comes from vir, it means man.
To pretend that a man is a woman, if he believes he is a woman, nobody should be mistreated. But that's not the same thing as requiring that people say objectively untrue things. If I believe I am something that I am not, it does not make me that thing.